أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم Dear students, السلام عليكم Welcome to our second portion of the discussion on this poem In the Waiting Room by Elizabeth Bishop. In the first part, we discussed some of the aspects of the poem. Here we are going to conclude our critical review of this poem by Elizabeth Bishop. Dear students, as we have gone through the textual reading of the poem and we have observed that Elizabeth Bishop is also very fearful of the unknown, the mysterious. She is wondering what her place in the world is and asks questions that do not have definitive answers. Reference to the big black wave is a metaphor for all of our fears and worries of the future, the mysterious future she has to go to, she has to enter, she has been forced to enter, rather, the world of the unknown, the world of adulthood, the outside world, where there is danger, where there is destruction, where there is something that is horrifying, as she sees the images in the magazine. A prominent theme in the poem is the fear of growing up and the fear of the unknown. This is an important theme of the poem and a very important one. The universe in which she is living is a universe of innocence. And now she is forced to step into the unknown world of adulthood. Then again, the world in which she is living is the world of isolation, seclusion. Whereas now she has to step into the larger world of participation. Now she has to go into the larger world of humanity, that is to say. Then again, we see that she has to combine with, she has to assimilate herself with all other human beings. And this fear of the unknown and the fear of the adulthood and growing up, taking the responsibilities, leaves many questions behind. Whether the poetess is afraid of the responsibilities and obligations of being adult, being a grown-up, or whether she has got some other horrible view and vision of being a grown-up person. The young Elizabeth is horrified by the images, and no doubt in it, she is rather shocked. She sees of the naked African women in the magazine because she is afraid of the signs of physical maturity in women. The signs are very obvious here, but she is horrified. If she grows like these images, she has to be mutilated, just like the hanging dead body, or she is again afraid of being a topless person facing the poverty or humiliation, exploitation at the doors of the larger world, the world around her. She states that their breasts were horrifying, and not they were horrifying. Human beings were not horrifying for her. She is ready to accommodate to the world of the human beings. But she is afraid of being just like these mutilated, wounded, and exploited human beings found in the pictures, painted in the pictures by the poetess. It could mean that she could see herself in the women. She thinks that these women are a mirror up of her own adulthood, that they may be. She is worried about the changes that her body will undergo as she matures, the biological changes, the physical changes she is afraid of. This fear of being an adult, just like these photographs, is the fear that is shivering and making her tremble, making her shocked. So, ye bete jo hai khauf hai, to be a grown up, just like these pictures, is a fear that is haunting her as a child. और वो फिर उसके साथ मिक्स हो जाता है फियर ऑफ द अननोन के साथ कि व्हाट मे हैपन इन फ्यूचर, व्हाट फ्यूचर स्टोर हैज गॉट इन स्टोर फॉर हर, एंड दिस फियर इज ओवरवेलमिंगली ओवरपावरिंग हर. डियर स्टूडेंट्स, लुकिंग एट द पोएम, वी हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस्ड दैट देयर आर सम elements of modernism and postmodernism in the poem. However, written in a stream of consciousness, technique and style, developed due to and shifting power structures, the escalations of warfare to a global level, a focus on the unconscious as an important source of motivation here, the poem differs from modernism by blurring the conventional boundary between high and low culture, by a completely loosened structure in both time and space, and by multiple openings rather than a closure of these matters discussed. Topics dealing with the complex absurdity of contemporary life, lack of a grand narrative, avoids traditional closure of themes or situations. Bishop had romances with various women, which was reflected in her poetry as well. That is the lesbian aspect of her life that is reflected in these very poems, of some of her poems. The poem presents surely a young girl's moment of awakening. This is another theme dealt here in the moment of awakening, the epiphany, the illumination of soul, the revelation to the separations and the bonds among human beings. There are so surely found separations in shape of class divisions, regional divisions, racial divisions, and there is a bond surely among human beings to the forces that shape individual identity through the interrelated recognitions of community and isolation. Maashre mein rehte hue हम इकट्ठे भी हैं और जुदा जुदा भी हैं. इंडिविजुअलिटी बरकरार रखना, जैसे कि वो बच्ची कोशिश कर रही है टू सेव हर सेल्फ फ्रॉम मिंगलिंग इन टू द कॉमन लॉट. वो नहीं चाहती कि वो बाहर की दुनिया के आम इंसानों के साथ उन जैसी बन जाए. वो अपनी इंडिविजुअलिटी को सेफ गार्ड करना चाहती है, बट शी इज़ फोर्स टू मिक्स अप विद मिंगल विद द आउटसाइड वर्ल्ड, लूजिंग एंड लिविंग बिहाइंड her own world of isolation. She has to be part of a community, the larger community of humanity. Elizabeth Bishop takes pains, for instance, to describe the contents of the magazine read by the young girl in the waiting room. Not only does she evoke in detail its pictures of volcanoes and of black naked women, but she specifies the particular issue of the magazine, identifying it as the National Geographic of February 1918. But Bishop, as Jerome Mazzero puts it, tempers with the actual contents of that magazine of that date and time. While that issue of the magazine does indeed contain an article on volcanoes, lavishly titled The Valley of 10,000 Smokes, and an account of the discovery and exploration of the most wonderful volcanic region in the world, it offers no images of babies with pointed heads, no pictures of black naked women with necks wound round and round with fire. So, beta, ye jo issue hai National Geographic ka, is par bahut logon ne research ki इसकी एक्चुअल सूरत हाल को जानने के लिए. फिर एलिजाबेथ बिशप से भी एक इंटरव्यू में पूछा गया कि आपने ये डिविएशन क्यों की, कि असल मैगज़ीन जो है इस तारीख का, इस पर तो कोई ऐसी तस्वीर नहीं है, तो आपने ये अपनी फैंसी से ली हैं. तो उसने बहरहाल गोलमोल सा जवाब देते हुए अपने इंटरव्यू में कहा कि नहीं नहीं ये हो सकता है मार्स का इशू हो। लेकिन जब मार्स के इशू को रिसर्च किया गया तो वहाँ भी ये तस्वीर नहीं थी। अलग है, ये पहला जो फरवरी का इशू है जिसका जिक्र इस नज़म में है, इसमें बहरहाल ये वॉल्केनो का एक आर्टिकल मौजूद है और हो सकता है एक तस्वीर भी हो। तो रिसर्चर्स ने इस पर भी बहुत काम किया, एक एक पॉइंट पर आपको पता है नज़म के लोग जो हैं बहुत रिसर्च करते हैं, तो रिसर्चर्स ने इस पर भी बहुत काम किया। डियर स्टूडेंट्स, देन देयर इज एन अदर इम्पॉर्टेंट थीम एंड इशू डिस्कस्ड इन डिटेल इन द पोएम, एंड दैट इज द इशू एंड थीम ऑफ आइडेंटिटी, सर्च फॉर सेल्फ। ये जो सर्च है, सोल सर्चिंग जो एक्टिविटी है, प्रोसेस है, वो पूरी नज़म का अहाता किए हुए हैं। कभी वो एक आइडेंटिटी में व्यवहार करती है, कभी दूसरी आइडेंटिटी की तरफ जो है वो व्यवहार करती हुई जो है वो जाती है। वो छोटी सी लड़की जो पेश की गई है माउथ पीस के तौर पर, पोइटस के माउथ पीस के तौर पर, तो बहरहाल ये जो इनसाइड आउट और आउटसाइड इन, ये जो सफ़र है, ये जो ट्रैवल है उस लड़की का टू फाइंड आउट द रियल आइडेंटिटी, रियल हर सेल्फ इज़ द मेन कंसर्न ऑफ द पोइटस, एंड शी हैज़ श्योरली डेल्ट विद दिस थीम एंड इशू इन डिटेल। देर इज़ नो इनसाइड इन दिस पोएम दैट कैन बी डिस्टिंग्विश्ड फ्रॉम इट्स आउटसाइड। द क्राई एमनेट्स फ्रॉम इनसाइड द डेंटिस्ट्स ऑफिस एंड फ्रॉम इनसाइड द वेटिंग रूम एंड फ्रॉम इनसाइड द नेशनल ज्योग्राफिक एंड फ्रॉम इनसाइड इन द वेटिंग रूम। इट्स अ क्राई दैट क्राइज आउट अगेंस्ट एनी अटेम्प्ट टू क्लैरिफाई इट्स कन्फ्यूजन्स बिकॉज इट इज अ फीमेल क्राई, ए क्राई ऑफ द फीमेल दैट ऑक्यूपाइज मैनी मैनी मीनिंग्स। इट मे बी ए क्राई ऑफ प्रोडक्टिविटी, द वोमैन मे बी गिविंग बर्थ, इट मे बी ए क्राई ऑफ चाइल्ड बर्थ, इट मे बी सम अदर क्राई, द क्राई ऑफ सम काइंड ऑफ एक्सप्लाइटेशन, फिजिकल अब्यूज दैट रिकग्नाइज द अटैम्प्ट टू क्लैरिफाई इट एज अटैम्प्ट टू पुट इट इन इट्स प्लेस, ए क्राई ऑफ डिसप्लेसमेंट इट मे बी, ए क्राई ऑफ एरोगेंस, ए क्राई ऑफ निगलेक्ट, ए क्राई ऑफ द फीमेल रिफ्यूजल ऑफ पोजिशन इन फेवर ऑफ डिसपोजिशन एज अ फिगरल ऑफ सबवर्जन। इट वेजेज वार अगेंस्ट द रिडक्शन ऑफ वीमेन टू द स्टेटस ऑफ ए लिटरल फिगर, उन्हें महज एक स्केल्टन के तौर पर, एक फिगर के तौर पर रखना, या यूं आम लफ्ज़ों में जैसे फेमिनिज्म के एडवोकेट्स कहते हैं महज एक टॉय थिंग समझना, ये इसके खिलाफ एक ये क्राई हो सकती है, क्राई अगेंस्ट एक्सप्लाइटेशन। एंड द वोमैन रिफ्यूजेस टू सिंपली बीइंग ए फिगर, एंड ऑक्सीमरोनिक एंटाइटी, और ये बड़ी कंट्राडिक्टरी किस्म की ऑक्सीमरोनिक एंटाइटी, कंस्ट्रेंड टू बी इंटरप्रेटेड विद इन द पेट्रियकल टेक्स्ट। तो ये मर्दों के माशरे के अंदर उसे मुकैद करके आप रख सकते हैं, नहीं रख सकते। इट इज़ अगेंस्ट दैट टेक्स्ट दैट द क्राई वेजेस वार, वार अगेंस्ट कंस्ट्रेंट्स, ए वार अगेंस्ट रिस्ट्रिक्शंस, लिमिटेशंस ऑन हर लिबर्टी एंड फ्रीडम बिकम्स ए वार क्राई टू अनलीश द टेक्सचुअलिटी दैट रेप्स द फैब्रिक ऑफ द कल्चरल टेक्स्ट। माशरे ने भी उस पर पाबंदियाँ आयद कर रखी हैं, समाज ने भी, तो इन पाबंदियों के खिलाफ ये एक तरह का ऐलान जंग, ये क्राई जो है, इट मे बी ए क्राई फॉर सम काइंड ऑफ वेजिंग वार अगेंस्ट दीज रिस्ट्रिक्शंस लिमिटेशंस सोशल टैबूज यू मे से द फीमेल सेक्ट हैज़ टू फेस। डियर स्टूडेंट्स, हाउएवर अ क्रिटिक विक्टोरिया हैरिसन argues that Bishop's poetry defies such distinctions of inside and outside, or rather it enacts a slippage in between these two extremes of inside and outside. There is no hierarchical opposition maintained in the poem, you see very well, whether between male and female, white and black, or inside and outside, but rather there is an oscillation that culminates in Elizabeth's identification with her aunt's cry. This is assimilation of her being, going into another being, literally and spiritually, becoming the other person sitting there as a child. Before the climax of the poem, the little girl, just like that in the story, is caught up in the language instability. She is unable to express her feelings. Although the poetess plunges deep into the psyche of the girl to bring out some suitable language to express her passions and feelings and emotions at that moment of epiphany, revelation, but the girl herself is unable to express her thoughts of the wavering identities she is experiencing right there. However, this child suffers in the process of the poem from the burden of stifling social categories. ये जो उस पर ये बोझ है अब ये उसके रूप पर बोझ बन गया है कि she is not able to identify herself as a child or an adult. She is not able to identify whether she is a child or adult. And the child of the story, as we have observed, has been able to postpone the penetration of the burden of the female identity. The responsibilities. Burden means the responsibilities, the obligations she is sure she has to face. The dangers in shape of the pictures she has just gone through, seen, looked at. And now she is also afraid of gaining that type of adulthood, the burden and responsibility and obligations and the duties rather she has to perform as an adult. She is able to postpone this identity of growing up. For a while, the scream of pain associated with feminine social obligations is silenced in the story until it is resumed again in the poem. Loom Bardi, another critic, explains how Elizabeth in the poem is possessed from within. She feels herself caught in an enmeshed community, herself crowded out by the presence of the collective behavior. Elizabeth drones under wave after black wave. ये जो inside out का यहाँ clash है, the girl, the little girl, is facing some kind of subversion. She is being submerged into the world of the unknown. Wave after wave, she is drowning into something deeper, something black, something horrible, something mysterious. Dear students, we can repeat the same quotation we just went through, that the poem presents a young girl's moment of awakening, revelation to the separations and the bonds among human beings. Both are there. The human beings are separate as well as they have got bonds among themselves. To the forces that shape individual liberty through the interrelated recognitions of community and isolation at the same time. To be in a waiting room is to be in a state of transition. This is another theme discussed in the poem. The state of transition. This transition, this change, is also there. The child changes from a child to an adult. The time changes from some childhood to adulthood. Then there is a change of consciousness. then there is a change of personality. Then there is a change of being secluded and then going into a communal gathering, altogetherness, that is. What awaits us on the other side of the door may be positive or negative. We are not sure what lies ahead in future. The fact that this poem is set in a dentist's waiting room does seem to suggest that what lies ahead is discomfort at best and pain at its worst. This idea is reinforced by Aunt Concilio, Bishop's Aunt Florence in real life, letting out a cry of pain, albeit a short one, although it is a very short one. Dear students, as we have already seen, this change of person, this transition from one awareness to another awareness, from one world to the other world, is a very phenomenal one in the poem. The young child in the poem, only a six-year-old Elizabeth Bishop, is about to enter a stage of her life where she leaves the rather self-absorbed innocence of childhood behind and sets tentative, hesitant foot in the more adult world. It is not a world with which she identifies in the least, yet she has an epiphany while in the waiting room, which leads her to see herself for the first time, her place in the world, and the various futures, the pictures of the future that await her in future, that is yet to come. Is there an inevitable path she must follow, or has she any control over her destiny? This is the question, and it has been left thirsty. No answer. क्या हम ये लड़की मजबूर है कि से ज़रूर जो है वो grow up होना ही होना है? Is it inevitable? The poem contains a number of profound philosophical questions as Bishop wrestles with this issue of transition. And is it the destiny of every child to grow? Then there is the theme of destiny. We are caught up in the web of destiny. Can we run away from our destiny that is supposed to be a fixed one, has got no flexibility? That is what makes the poem much more complex phenomenon at its onset. ये तकदीर का जो मामला है उसको भी यहाँ डिस्कस किया गया है कि क्या भाई बहसियत इंसान हमारी अपनी कोई चॉइस नहीं है. वी आर फोर्स टू बी ए चाइल्ड, वी आर फोर्स टू बी ए ग्रोन अप, देन वी आर फोर्स टू बी अलोन, एंड देन वी आर फोर्स टू बी ए पार्ट ऑफ द लार्जर वर्ल्ड. तो ये जो ना हक हम मजबूरों पे, ये तोहमत है मुख्तारी की, जो चाहते हैं सो आप करें, हमको अब बस बदनाम किया. तो क्या ये ह्यूमन बीइंग्स हैव गॉट सम काइंड ऑफ अ चॉइस? दिस इज़ अ वेरी डिफिकल्ट आंसर एंड वेरी वेरी डिफिकल्ट क्वेश्चन एज इट रिलेट्स टू रिलीजियस कंटेंट एज वेल. तकदीर के लिखे को कोई मिटा नहीं सकता, ये इस तरह के जुमले आप सुनते रहते हैं. इकबाल जैसे लोग इस पर यकीन नहीं रखते, और भी बहुत से लोग जो हैं वो कहते हैं कि इंसान अपनी तकदीर खुद बनाता है. तो बहरहाल हम इसके अदबी नुक्ता नज़र को ही सिर्फ ज़हन में रखें तो हमारे लिए बेहतर है, ताकि मज़ीद जो है वो ज़हन हमारा कन्फ्यूजन का शिकार ना हो. कीपिंग आवर सेल्व्स टू द लिमिटिंग रादर आवर सेल्व्स टू दिस थीम ऑफ द फिक्स्ड डेस्टिनी प्रेजेंटेड इन दिस पोएम, अ चेंज इज श्योरली टू टेक प्लेस. एंड दिस चेंज, दिस ट्रांजिशन हैज़ टू बी द चेंज फ्रॉम childhood to adulthood, to be a grown one, from a small particle of this world to a bigger persona in practical life. Dear students, now we have to look back at the contents of the poem again to come to a reasonable conclusion of this discussion. The poem opens with simple statements of fact, as we have read it textually, telling us the time and space in which the events of the poem took place. The language is surely a matter of fact, straightforward, day-to-day, everyday language, and is practical, as befits a six-year-old child. No philosophical analogies are there, or any other thing. The language, the word, the choice of words is very simple and smart, as a child uses simple words, matter-of-fact language. The scene is one of normality. The scene is also very normal. It is the waiting room of a dentist, and childhood boredom has been depicted while a child is sitting amongst the people who are not of her age group. She is alone as a child there, and other people are all grown-ups, adults. The young girl is stuck in a room full of grown-ups with whom she has nothing in common. That is the thing. वो महसूस करती है कि she is isolated, just as she is isolated in childhood. तो यहाँ भी कमरे में भी उसको isolation का सामना है. No commonality is to be found in this crowd. लोग बहुत है वहाँ, एक अजूम जमा है grown-ups का उस waiting room में. Sitting silent, mom, and she is also there to keep waiting for the return of her aunt. The adults sitting there are not seen as individuals. Remember this. This is an important point here. But are grouped together as wearers of overcoats and galoshes, the same kind of dress. The similarity among these people is the similarity of the dress they are wearing. And this young girl is sitting, feeling that she is all alone there. Although she is sitting amongst these people. The adults sitting are not individuals at all. They are presented as a community, as the same. So, beta, ye individuality versus collectiveness ka issue jo hai, usko yahan shuru hi mein scene ki setting ke saath hi pesh kiya gaya hai. Bishop's aunt is in the dentist surgery room, the treatment room, and the poet passes the time by reading the National Geographic magazine. The accurate recollection of a child's view of the world is captured in the comment on the length of time Aunt Consilio seems to be taking in the surgery or the treatment, and also in the girl's pride in her ability to read even though she is only six. And it is amazing that a six-year-old child is able to read something thoroughly, even a magazine. Then the pictures and articles in the magazine depict a world that seems a million miles away from the mundane dentist's waiting room in Massachusetts. The world depicted in the magazine is a different type of world from that of the world presented in the setting of the poem. The first image is of a volcano erupting, disturbing, dangerous, horrifying, fiery, and this immediately introduces a note of danger. The outside world can be a threatening, violent place. This is a suggestion by the scene, by the picture, by the image. We will discuss all these images one by one while we are recapitulating the whole poem. The outside world can be a threatening, violent place, fiery. Next, the little girl looks at a photograph of the African explorers Uzzah and Martin Johnson in their strange attire of pith helmets and riding breeches. A picture of a dead man slung on a pole with the caption "Long Pig" underneath suggests that the corpse is to be eaten and cannibalized. This is a deeply disturbing, horrifying image. Although it is not clear whether or not the young poet would have known that "long pig" refers to the similarity between human flesh and the pork. Either way, the dead man being carried so ignominiously would be bound to unsettle a child horribly. Incongruously, जिसे कहते हैं अब. The images which follow are equally grotesque and full of implied pain and cruelty inflicted on people by members of their own race. This is again important here, that the mutilation of these images, the mutilation presented in shape of the ropes bound on the heads of the young babies, and this corpse, mutilated corpse of a dead man, all represent suppression, pain and misery found in the larger world of human beings. And this is a suggestion again that they are being mutilated and exploited and oppressed by their own race. In certain parts of the Congo, babies' heads were wound with strings and ropes to artificially elongate the growing skull. उसको गर्दन को और ये यहाँ सर को बच्चों को जो है वो रस्सियाँ, ये इमेज को हम बड़ी तफसील से पहले ही डिस्कस कर चुके हैं. बहरहाल यहाँ जो पॉइंट हमने निकाल रहे हैं अपनी इस रिकैप्चुलेशन से, वो वाजे होते जा रहे हैं कि ये जो इनको पेन और सफरिंग का टारगेट दिखाया गया है, ये असल में इंसान ही इंसान के जो है ये तबाही का बायस है. जैसे कि आगे आखिरी एक स्टेंजा में उसने वो वार की मौजूदगी का जिक्र किया है कि स्टिल इन द आउटर वर्ल्ड देयर इज द हॉरिफाइंग द डिस्ट्रक्टिव द रेनियस वार इज गोइंग ऑन एंड दिस काइंड ऑफ एक्सप्लाइटेशन of these human beings is also being done, being carried out. This cruelty against humanity is carried out by human beings, human race. Nobody else is to blame. It is the humankind who are doing this. In some other parts of Africa, women placed metal rings, as we have already debated it in the earlier part of our discussion, around their necks, adding to the number all the time of these rings or wires in order to stretch their necks in a way considered beautiful by those around them, human beings around them. The result appalls the young poet, as do the photographs of topless African women with awful hanging breasts. There is a strange compulsion in the images nonetheless, and now that she has begun reading, Bishop feels too shy to stop. Perhaps she feels that if she puts the magazine down or looks up, she will draw attention of other people to herself and her reading material as well. Or perhaps she can't bear to meet the eyes of those in the waiting room, lest they know what she is reading. When she has read through to the end of the magazine, Bishop focuses on the familiar and unthreatening cover of the National Geographic, less threatening rather, and its bright yellow margins. There is a sense and a suggestion again in which the margins put a neat frame around the contents of the magazine and somehow make them more controlled, balanced and less threatening. Balance is produced by these margins on the title of the magazine. बेटे जो पॉइंट है ना यहाँ जो हमारे मतलब का है कि स्ट्रेंज टाइप ऑफ कंपल्शन इज फेल्ट बाय द चाइल्ड. दिस टाइप ऑफ कंपल्शन, व्हाट टाइप ऑफ कंपल्शन इट इज़, ये बेटे कंपल्शन है कि वो इन तस्वीर को देख कर जो है ना वो सोच रही है कि ये शायद मुझे भी ये जो है वो करेक्टर अडॉप्ट करना पड़ेगा, देन आई एम गोइंग टू बी ए ग्रोन अप ह्यूमन बीइंग। तो इस तरह से वो और ज़्यादा जो है वो खौफजदा हो जाती है। दिस रेवलेशन ऑफ आइडेंटिटी, अ न्यू आइडेंटिटी, न्यू बोर्न आइडेंटिटी रादर, जस्ट स्टार्टल्स एंड डेजल्स हर एंड शी इज शॉक्ड फ्रॉम विदन, रैटल्ड फ्रॉम विदन। सिमिलरली द डेट ऑन द कवर इज ए कंक्रीट एंड इनऑफेंसिव फोकल पॉइंट, इट रूट्स द पोएट बैक टू द प्रेजेंट एंड ब्रिंग्स हर बैक टू द डल बट नॉर्मल सराउंडिंग्स ऑफ द डेंटिस्ट्स वेटिंग रूम। रादर यू मे से दैट दिस ट्रांजिशन ऑफ लुकिंग एट द टाइटल brings a relief from that cry of pain she feels in her throat, that cry of the newly identified recognition identity she is forced to adopt to। तो बेटे ये एक तरह से इसे relief भी देता है, जिसे हम momentary stay against anger और anguish कहते हैं। वो momentary stay जो है वो ये इसे जब वो title को देखने लगती है तो वो वापस आ जाती है अपनी मौजूदा पोजीशन में, और उसे फिर सुकून मिलता है ज़हनी तौर पर, रूहानी तौर पर, कि नो शी आई एम नॉट येट ग्रोन अप, आई एम स्टिल अ चाइल्ड, आई नीड नॉट वरी अबाउट द अपकमिंग डेंजर्स ऑफ द न्यू आइडेंटिटी, द फोर्स्ड आइडेंटिटी रादर, शी कम्स बैक टू द प्रेजेंट फ्रॉम द फ्यूचर शी हैज़ बिन वंडरिंग अबाउट। It is worth noting here that despite the detailed descriptions of the February 1918 issue of the National Geographic, the facts we are presented with are not quite true। ये बात हम पहले ही बड़े डिस्कस कर चुके हैं, लेकिन हम पढ़ेंगे दोबारा ज़रा। एक रिसर्चर ने इस पर बड़ी बात की है। Certainly, Bishop visited the dentist with her aunt. This is a true depiction from her biography. It is mentioned elsewhere in her poetry as well, but the February 1918 issue of the magazine didn't show pictures of African women or babies at all, although it had an article on the volcano. When Elizabeth Bishop was questioned about this deviation in the poem from the factual happenings in the magazine, in an interview, instead of confessing that she has made it poetic, or it is part of her fancy and imagination, rather she claimed to have mixed up the February and March editions of the National Geographic magazine. However, the March edition also doesn't contain any images of such African women or babies. The critic Lee Edelman claims that the very attempt to pin down the literal truth of the stories of the oppression of women and children is a part of the very mindset that causes such oppression in the first place. Edelman again says that by trying to prove the factual truth of the young bishop's memories, we are guilty of trying to put female cries of pain in their fair place. His argument is that anyone who does so is ignoring the fundamental truth in what Bishop is saying and is seeking refuge in literal truth rather than facing the uncomfortable facts. So, shayari ki duniya mein palan le rahi hai, fancy ki duniya mein haqaiq se nazrein chura kar, to ye ek उसे हम कह सकते हैं कि शी हैज़ गॉट द राइट टू डिविएट एज अ पोएट। तो थोड़ा बहुत अगर इनहराफ करके उसने अपने थीम कन्वे करने की कोशिश की है तो इट इज़ नॉट अ क्राइम और इट इज़ नॉट अ गिल्ट ऑफ द कॉन्शियंस, इट इज़ जस्ट अ पोएटिक डिविएशन। एंड दैट कोई भी आप तहरीर ले लें तो वो मुकम्मल तौर पर तो हकायक को पेश नहीं ना करती, उसमें कुछ ना कुछ ड्रामाटाइजेशन, पोएटिक फैंसी जो है वो उसमें कुछ ना कुछ तो होती है ना। तो यहाँ भी शायरा ने जो डिविएशन की है, इट इज़ नॉट होल टुगेदर टू बी blamed on her part. It is a poetic deviation, and it makes the poem much clearer, much fascinating, and deeper than usual. Dear students, coming to the concluding portion of our discussion on this poem, we may like to go back to the question of the inside and outside meanings. Suddenly, there is a cry from inside. The inside here could be the dentist's surgery or the inside of the poet's mind. It is the sound of Aunt Consuelo's voice as she makes an exclamation of pain. With the characteristic harshness of the young, Bishop notes that Aunt Consuelo is a foolish, timid woman. जैसे बच्चे ये judgmental हो जाते हैं बड़ों के बारे में, तो ये भी एक judgmental phrase है, उसको foolish, timid woman कहना. और rather ये एक और इसमें pun भी है कि she would not like to become like her, although she is forced to become like her as she assimilates and identifies herself to be her aunt. Who could be expected to make such a noise? The noise she makes doesn't surprise Bishop, but what does take her completely by surprise is the realization that the voice could be hers as easily as Aunt Consuelo's herself. At this moment of epiphany, Bishop identifies with Aunt Consuelo and recognizes the similarities between both of them. Might she grow up to be just like her aunt? This is a big question for a small child. Or is the cry, oh, the young poet's anguish on reading the magazine and seeing the lengths to which people, particularly women, have to go and the pain they are forced to suffer in order to fit in with societal norms, as we have already elaborated that this type of cry, or oh, maybe the reasons are so many. It may be caused by childbirth, it may be caused by the exploitation of women, it may be a physical cry, or it may be a spiritual cry. You may refer it to anything. Again, it has been argued that it is irrelevant to obsess over the origin of the oh, as it is the voice of all of those who have been forced into constraint. किसी भी तरह की आप किसी पर पाबंदियाँ लगाएं, किसी को कैद में कर डाल दें, लिटरल और मेटाफोरिकल, तो ये कराई तो अंदर से आती है, ये वो आवाज़ है बगावत की, रिबिलियन की, जिसे आप कह सकते हैं. दिस इज़ नॉट अ क्राई ऑफ पेन, इट माइट बी ए क्राई ऑफ रिबिलियन, ए क्राई ऑफ वॉर अगेंस्ट ऑपरेशन एंड सप्रेशन ऑन द होल. The young bishop is overwhelmed by a sudden realization, a revelation, that she is part of the human race and is not separate from it, and as she might have believed up to now as a child. The horrifying pictures of women in the National Geographic are not that different from what she will become when she is older and grown up. The grown-ups she dismissed as hardly worthy of a second glance are like herself, human beings. Will she be like them when she grows up, exploiting others, killing others, mutilating others? The war is there. The girl feels like she may faint and thus clings to hard facts such as the cover of the National Geographic and her upcoming birthday to stop herself becoming lost in the overwhelming rush of emotions. She is trying to get out of this flood of epiphany, and again she is also trying to get out of this trance of transition from one consciousness to another. ये बेटे जो है ये असल में इस बात से जो है वो खौफजदा है कि क्या बड़े होकर मुझे भी ये सब कुछ जो बर्दाश्त करना पड़ेगा, ये ह्यूमिलिएशन, ये एक्सप्लाइटेशन, ये ऑपरेशन, ये जुल्म व सितम, जो इंसान इंसान के साथ रवा रखे हुए हैं, ये कत्ल वगारत, ये म्यूटिलेशन जो वो देखती है, साइंस ऑफ म्यूटिलेशन आर देयर इन दोज इमेजेस विच शी हैज जस्ट गॉन थ्रू इन द मैगजीन, एंड देन द हिंट ऑफ वॉर, द वर्ल्ड वॉर वन. शी थिंक्स दैट द आउटसाइड वर्ल्ड, द वर्ल्ड ऑफ द ग्रोन अप्स, इज ए वर्ल्ड ऑफ डेंजर, इज ए वर्ल्ड ऑफ द अननोन, इज a world of exploitation, and she just shies away, she just trembles away to get out of this world of reality by bringing unto her mind that she is still a child. She remembers her birthday that is yet to come after 3 or 4 days. Dear students, then there is a note of defiance surely in the poem when the young poet asks herself why she should be one of them. This is some kind of rebellion, but you know very well this type of rebellion, the voice, the cry of pain, is not a louder a type of rebellious attitude on the part of the poetess. As you know very well, Elizabeth Bishop is a poetess of balance, is a poetess of restraint, is a poetess of perfection. Although she voices for the female folk as a feminist poet, but still she is not a Sylvia Plath or an Adrienne Rich. She has got her own way of talking, her way of conveying the meaning, conveying the sense she wishes to convey to the reader, to the world at large. Therefore, her rebellion is there, her defiance is there, her disobedience is there, surely. The outcry is there. The voice against suppression is there in the poem, but it is a humbled tone. It is a restrained tone. You may say that it is a cultured type of defiance or rebellion against society. As she thinks that after all, she is part of this society after all. She steals a shy glance at the adults around her, but only sees dull, grey, shadowy legs in trousers and shirts and skirts and boots. The important realization for that little girl is that she is not, as she may have thought, unique at all. She is just like her family, just like the adults in the waiting room, and even like the rather terrifying figures in the magazine, the outer world at large. She is but a human being after all, and she has to be a human being. She is not unique. She wonders about the similarities between herself and others, and asks how it is that she happens to be in the waiting room in Massachusetts while in other parts of the world people are suffering strange and unnecessary mutilations, exploitations, suppressions. There is no attempt to answer these questions on the part of the poetess, and the feeling of faintness rises up again after going through this poem. The waiting room seems too hot, and everything around her begins to turn dark and gloomy, black. Suddenly the shock subsides and the poet feels normality again. Just as the poem began with details about the time and place, so it ends with a restating of those facts. Normality regained. The difference, the only difference, and it is a significant one, is that the First World War is included in the description of the poem. But is not dealt in detail. No pointing remarks are to be found. It is a reminder that even though the poet is in a place that is both secure, that may appear dull and unthreatening, war is raging elsewhere in the world. The outside world is a dangerous place, horrific one, and now the poet knows that she can't remain apart from it forever. After all, she has to plunder into it. She has to enter into this larger world of humanity. Aziz talba o talibat, hamari is taweel guftgu ka ikhtitam hua, lekin aaj ke is discussion ko ikhtitam pazeer karne se pehle aaiye ek do jumle jo hain aapki mazid further clarification of the mind ke liye ki ye nizam जो है वो हम इम्तहानी तौर पर कैसे डील करेंगे. तो बेटे यहाँ आपने देखा कि यहाँ थीम ऑफ अलाइनेशन, आइसोलेशन, सिक्लूशन, उसको बड़ी खूबसूरती से डील किया गया है. थीम ऑफ चाइल्डहुड एंड एडल्टहुड जो है वो भी मौजूद हैं. फिर इसके बाद थीम ऑफ एक्सप्लॉयटेशन एट द हैंड्स ऑफ सुपीरियर बीइंग्स, सो कॉल्ड सुपीरियर बीइंग्स, लोअर बीइंग्स की एक्सप्लॉयटेशन, उसका भी जिक्र मौजूद है. फिर ये जो खतरात हैं इंसानी ज़िंदगी में, इंसानी दुनिया में, इन शेप ऑफ पावर्टी, इन शेप ऑफ लो इनकम ग्रुप्स, उसका भी जिक्र मौजूद है. तो वो जो पिक्चर्स हैं अफ्रीकन पिक्चर्स, विच आर वेरी डिस्टर्बिंग नॉट ओनली फॉर द गर्ल, द लिटिल गर्ल, बट ऑल्सो फॉर द रीडर्स एज वेल. तो बेटे वो तस्वीरें जो हैं वो सिंबॉलिकली, मेटाफोरिकली जो है वो हमें ये इस हकीकत की तरफ जो है वो इशारा है कि दुनिया में गुर्बत, दुनिया में एक्सप्लॉयटेशन इस हद तक है कि इंसान इंसान को जो है वो नोच रहा है और उसके पास जो है वो अपना जिस्म ढांपने के लिए लबास तक जो है वो मैसर नहीं है, और दूसरी तरफ इंसान अपने वसाइल का ज़िया कर रहा है जंग की शक्ल में, दूसरों को मारने में, बजाय इसके कि हम दुनिया में मोहब्बत और अखुवत को और इक्वलिटी को जो है वो किसी तरह लाएं. हम एक्सप्लॉयटेशन और ह्यूमिलिएशन लोगों की जो है वो करते फिर रहे हैं. तो दिस इज़ ऑल पार्ट ऑफ द लार्जर गेम ऑफ ह्यूमैनिटी, इसे हम कहेंगे. तो वो मैसेज नज़म का जो है वो बड़ा क्लियर है थीम की शक्ल में कि आफ्टर ऑल वी आर पार्ट ऑफ दिस ह्यूमन रेस, बट ह्यूमन रेस शुड कंसिडर सर्टन पॉइंट्स वेयर देर इज़ नो एक्सप्लॉयटेशन ऑफ एनी काइंड. नंबर वन, नो एक्सप्लॉयटेशन ऑफ हायर और लोअर. नंबर टू, देर शुड बी नो जेंडर एक्सप्लॉयटेशन एट ऑल इन शेप ऑफ कंसिडरिंग वीमेन द लोअर क्रिएचर्स एंड द मैन एज हायर क्रिएचर्स. तो ये बेटे पैगाम जो है वो आवाज़ जो है वो अगरचे शायरा की बड़ी धीमी है लेकिन रिबिलियस है. जो एटीट्यूड है वो रिबिलियस है. क्वेश्चंस आर आस्क्ड बट दे आर नॉट आंसर्ड एट ऑल एलेबोरेटली, लेफ्ट टू द रीडर टू बी आंसर्ड. हमें खुद बेटे इसमें से जो है वो इनसाइसिव क्वेश्चंस में से हमें खुद जो है वो जवाबात इसके देने हैं, ढूंढने हैं, अपने अपने कल्चर के मुताबिक, अपनी अपनी सोच के मुताबिक, अपने अपने विजन के मुताबिक कि हम क्या सोचते हैं. द पोएट सेज लेफ्ट अस विद ए फूड फॉर थॉट. और हमें जो है वो एक और नुक्ता जो बड़ा कीमती है कि बेटे ये एलिजाबेथ बिशप अगरचे जो है वो फेमिनिस्ट की एक नुमाइंदा फेमिनिस्ट पोएट है, लेकिन बेटे इसकी जो लवो लहजा है वो आम फेमिनिस्ट पोएट्स के मुकाबले में हटकर है, धीमा, उस तरह से लाउड नहीं है जैसे सिल्विया प्लैद या एंड्रियन रिच जैसे शोरा जो हैं वो लाउडली जो है वो ख़वातीन के लिए आवाज़ बुलंद करते हैं या आउटबर्स्ट ऑफ इमोशंस में चले जाते हैं. तो देर यू विल फाइंड इन हर पोएट्री ए बैलेंस. ऑल्दो शी वॉइसेस फॉर द वुमेन बट शी कीप्स हर वॉइस हम्बल्ड, बैलेंस्ड, रेस्ट्रेंट रादर. पाबंदियाँ पसंद भी नहीं करती और पाबंदियों को समझती है कि ये ज़िंदगी का हिस्सा भी हैं. दे मेक लाइफ अ बेटर लिविंग अबाउट. तो इसके अलावा बेटे और भी यहाँ बहुत से नकात जो हैं वो हमारे समझने के लिए मौजूद हैं। आपको मेरी ये गुजारिश है कि आप वो एक वीडियो मैंने शामिल की है यूट्यूब चैनल पर, जब आप अपनी यूट्यूब चैनल पर जाएं जहाँ ये लेसन्स पढ़े हैं आपके पढ़ने के लिए, तो बेटे वहाँ जो है ना वो चैनल के ऊपर एक प्लेलिस्ट आएगी जिस पर आपकी क्लास का नाम दर्ज होगा। आप अपना सेवन्थ सेमेस्टर की क्लास खोलें तो वहाँ जो है ना इस नज़म पर आपको कुछ मैंने वेबसाइट से कुछ वीडियोस जो हैं वो लिंक की हैं, सेव की हैं। प्लीज़ उनको भी ज़रूर साथ साथ पढ़ें, ख़ास तौर पर एक अंग्रेज़ी की बहुत अच्छी एक्सप्लेनेशन इस नज़म की और एलिजबेथ बिशप के लिए बहुत अच्छी जो है वो इंटरप्रिटेशन एक टीचर ने की है, वो मैंने सेव की हुई है। प्लीज़ उसको ज़रूर गो थ्रू कीजिएगा। If you have got any questions about these two poems about from Elizabeth Bishop, you may please ask in your groups. And now it is the conclusion of our discussion about this poem. Dear students, thank you very much for being with me till our next discussion and conversation. It is Allah Hafiz and goodbye from my side. Thank you very much again.